The residents of Edmonton, Alberta, woke to a crisp and chilly morning on Christmas Day of 1996. Mother of three, Mary Ghostkeeper, woke to prepare for the traditional festivities, excited to spend time with her loved ones. Her 24-year-old daughter, Joanne, who was the youngest of Mary and husband Daniel's children, was due to visit at some point during the afternoon to give presents to her children, Martina, aged 8, and Lauren, aged 5, who were staying with their maternal grandparents. Joanne and her parents both lived in the city, and their residences were not very far from one another, and it was assumed that she would arrive in good time, but she failed to appear. Time ticked by with no sign of Joanne, her son and daughter bemused as to where their mother was. Anxious, Mary called her husband, Daniel, to check on their daughter at her apartment. Daniel Ghostkeeper arrived at the home and knocked on the door several times, but failed to get a response. He immediately called Edmonton Police, expressing his concerns regarding Joanne's welfare. Police arrived at Ghostkeeper's residence at 11925 34th Street in Northeast Edmonton at approximately 5:30 p.m. on Christmas Day. Investigating the home, which was located on the fourth floor, officers found the lifeless body of Joanne Ghostkeeper. She had been strangled to death with an electrical phone cord, and police ruled her death as a homicide, Joanne being the 18th homicide victim in Edmonton during 1996. A timeline was pieced together through eyewitness testimonies, which placed Joanne at the Saloon Bar in the Beverly Crest Travel Lodge in Edmonton on the evening of the 22nd of December at approximately 8 p.m. Earlier that day, she had called her father, the pair discussing gifts for her children, Joanne finishing the call by stating she was going out to drink with friends and confirmed that she would see the family on the 25th of December. This was the last time Daniel ever heard his daughter's voice. At Beverly Crest, she had been seen with a small group of people, including one woman and a few men, all of whom were asked to leave the premises by the bartender at around 1 a.m. on the 23rd of December. The 24-year-old was last seen alive at 1:15 a.m. in the company of three unidentified males. What occurred following this sighting is unknown, however, detectives have theorised that the group more than likely returned to Ghostkeeper's apartment just a block away in the early hours of the morning. Joanne Ghostkeeper was known to live a risky lifestyle and hosted many parties at her residence. When police arrived at her apartment, it was described as being in an unkempt condition, and furthermore, her black cat was found wandering in and out of Ghostkeeper's apartment. According to some sources, police believe that the young woman, who was said to have been a heavy drinker, may have been involved in sex trafficking and could possibly have been a victim of a serial killer. It was noted that the presents Joanne had wrapped during her phone call to her father a few days prior were nowhere to be found. Years went by with no answers. In 2004, Mary, who had kept a roll of film she retrieved from her daughter's belongings in 1997, got photographs developed, showing pictures of her late daughter in the company of two men who she did not recognise. Edmonton police shared the photos in the hope of identifying the individuals, which turned out to be a success. However, the men were unable to provide any clues to detectives. Christmas was not celebrated by the family for 16 years, their only tradition being the act of lighting a candle in memory of Joanne. Mary was of Sucker Creek First Nation, and throughout her childhood, Joanne participated in powwows and other activities relating to her Indigenous heritage. She was described as being incredibly kind and was a devoted mother to her children. Sadly, even after suffering heartbreak with the death of Joanne, the Ghostkeeper family experienced further tragedy. Daniel and Mary's two sons, Curtis and Lawrence, who was also named Daniel in other sources, had struggled to cope with life after the murder of their beloved sister, and both died due to drug-related complications, leaving Daniel and Mary devastated. In 2010, Joanne's children, now adults, along with Mary, who is now known as Mary Willier, moved to Driftpile Cree Nation, a place they felt at ease, away from the bustling city. It was also the place Mary was born, and where Joanne was laid to rest. Mary has expressed her pride at being grandmother of Lorne and Martina, both of whom have experienced great successes in life, despite their tragic loss at such a young age. There is currently a $40,000 reward for information leading to an arrest for the murder of Joanne. According to a 2016 CBC News article, Canada's Minister for the Status of Women said that based on a report by the Native Women's Association of Canada and the 2008 Walk for Justice initiative, it is estimated that possibly over 4,000 Indigenous women and girls have gone missing or have been murdered in Canada between the 1970s and present day, with the majority of cases remaining unsolved. No arrests have ever been made regarding Joanne Ghostkeeper's death. However, Edmonton police have kept the case open, and the Ghostkeeper family hope that answers will soon be found.